Before we get into this episode, there's something that might be of interest that I wanted to tell you about. Seen and Heard, who run this podcast, have been asked by Scotland Food and Drink to undertake a strategic review of the Scotland Food and Drink Excellence Awards. Now, these Excellence Awards have been going for almost 20 years and are a huge mainstay of the food and drink sector, but it's time to ensure that they're still relevant. So if you have ever been involved in the Scotland Food and Drink Excellence Awards, or even if you've ever had an opinion about them, we would love for you please to complete our survey. So if you go to the On Farm Twitter, which is at @on_farmuk, and click the link in the bio, there will be a tab in there that will take you to the survey, and it should only take you a very short while to complete, but we would be enormously grateful. Hello and welcome to the On Farm podcast. We are back, but in the midst of coronavirus, so we're doing things somewhat differently today. We're not on farm, at least I'm not. I am in a tiny room in my house that I've padded with cushions and blankets to try and get the right kind of noise. We are speaking to Jill from Connage Highland Dairy, and Jill is on farm today because she can safely be there. So she is going to be talking to us about her cheese business and how it's been impacted by coronavirus and the different ways in which they've innovated. So really looking forward to Jill, and I hope you enjoy listening. Hi, Jill. How are you?
Oh, hi, Anna. It's lovely to see you. Well, I'm not seeing you, am I? It's lovely to speak to you.
Yeah, you too. Ordinarily, of course, I would be there with you and we'd be recording this podcast together.
Yeah.
But obviously, we're in the midst of coronavirus at the moment, so we're doing it remotely. But thank you very much for taking the time. I know you've got a lot of orders processing at the moment, so thank you very much for taking the time to talk to us. Now, I know we are in the grips of coronavirus, but I don't want that to be the only thing that we talk about today. So can you maybe start just by telling me a little bit about the history of Connage Highland Dairy and where you when you started and why?
Sure. Well, Connage Highland Dairy, we've now been going for 14 years.
Wow, that's
and
a long time.
The reason why, I know, it's just gone so quickly. The reason why we started was because, the farm's organic and the milk prices dropped. Mm. So we thought that to add value, because there's Callum and his brother Cameron, you know, what do they do? It's kind of quite scary to think they've been on the farm all their lives and to actually go and do something else. So we thought we'd add value to the milk, and that's where it all came about. We got a marketing grant, and we just looked in all different directions for what to do with the milk. You know, ice cream or yogurt or cheese. And cheese, we found, was the best option because it used all of our milk.
That's how it kind of started.
Yeah, so that was a long time ago. And
yeah,
we sort of built the building and did a few cheese courses. And then it's kind of like the milk came in. Okay, we've got to deal with this. So we ended up to be cheesemakers.
And excellent cheesemakers at that, because I know you've won World Cheese Awards and more.
Pretty
good at what you do.
A lot of it, Anna, is really the milk. The milk and the skill of the cheesemaker, and that's where Callum's really come to the fore, from going from a dairy farmer to a cheesemaker.
Yes.
But the milk is lovely. It really is. It's very special, and it's got good fat and protein in it, and you know, it makes good cheese. Mm.
And I think I can hear Callum in the background, because you're sitting in your office at the moment. The phones are ringing with orders coming in, which is really positive news. And Callum, I can hear him in the background dealing with those. So that's brilliant. But the milk, what is it that makes the milk so special then?
Well, it's because they're grass-fed, so it's on-farm grass-fed. It's a high clover diet. Cameron feeds them with red and white clover. And it's just a mixture of the grass and what we're feeding them. And they're happy cows, because we've got two robotic stations, which means that they can, you know, come in and milk whenever they feel like it. And I just think a relaxed cow gives better milk. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I'm sure many dairy farmers would agree with you. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Now, we're talking in the midst, of, as I've said, of coronavirus. Before this came along, you have a shop and an amazing chilled cheese room up at Conage Highland Dairy, which is close to Inverness. You sell online and you also sell through wholesalers as well. Can you tell me a bit about how things have changed in the last few weeks since we entered into lockdown?
Yes, well, we've had to furlough the staff, mm-hmm. but we've still got two dispatch staff going because obviously the cheeses need to be turned in the big store, and also we've gone a lot more online. We didn't have much online because we've got about 50 cheeses in the cheese room in the shop. So I've been busy putting those onto the website, and we've had an uplift in online orders, which has been fantastic.
Oh, good.
And I have to say, to get the response that we've had for a small company, I was actually getting quite teary about it because it's just the wonderful support that we've had. And also people are ringing up and ordering, and we pay over the phone, and then we just leave the order on a table outside and they come and collect, so mm-hmm. it's quite a lot safer. But it's really been terribly difficult because furloughing the staff, I ring around once a week and speak to them all double check that they're okay. And some of them we're doing online training, sort of first aid training and mm-hmm. Different hygiene courses that they can do. It's just awfully lonely here without them all, I have to say. We miss we're a bit like a family here, and we really miss them.
You've got two of your very excellent and loyal team still working at the dairy, obviously under the strict rules and regulations. And
they are
in dispatch, aren't they? So they're the uplift in consumer orders that you've had. Magda and Merrick are dealing with those. Do you think you could take us on a little walking tour?
Of course.
And we can go through and see what they're up to.
Yes, of course. They're just they're cutting cheese at the moment. And sorry, I just dropped the phone. Sorry. I was just going to say, I'm just walking around to dispatch. I thought you might like to hear what Merrick and Magda are doing. So I'm just... we're coming into the dry goods area. Magda and Merrick are cutting and vacuum packing cheese. Hi, Merrick. Yeah, hi. What they're doing is they're cutting the cheese and vacuum packing it, ready to go out for orders to shops. You'll hear the vacuum packer going. It's been quite difficult. We've had to move the tables around so they continue to, have social distancing as well. So there's been quite a few changes.
So you've lost quite a lot, if not all, of your wholesale business. Not permanently, but for the time being.
Just for the time being. And, of course, a lot of that is because the hotels are shut and... But wholesalers are working around different markets. They're all looking at, like us, how we can reach the public, mm-hmm. Different ways. It's just a different way of trading. We couldn't be. Magda's actually, she lives north of Inverness, and Callum and I have been out delivering to Inverness and Nan, and Magda's been doing home deliveries north of Inverness as well. So we're all pulling together as the four of us,
Now is a time when, if you are still working in a situation like this, traditional job descriptions slightly go out the window and everybody pulls in and does different things to make it all happen, don't they? It's about doing things differently in order to meet the demand that is there and keeping in with all of the social distancing rules too. Magda and Merrick, how are they coping with it, do you think?
Well, they're quite good. I mean, obviously, they're missing the other staff as well. Being a small business, we all help each other.
Yeah.
So when it gets really busy, the production staff come down to dispatch or vice versa.
Mm-hmm.
So they're missing the social interaction as well.
Oh, that sounds like an interesting noise. What was
Yeah, well, that's the vacuum packer.
Oh, cool.
I know.
That sounds very sci-fi.
It does, doesn't it?
Yeah. Oh, dear. And so presumably, have you put a hold on actual cheese production at the moment?
Yes, we have, Anna. The milk is instead of us making cheese, is going down to the processor. So we're lucky in the fact, I mean, we've been reading about some of the dairy farmers having to pour the milk down the drain because that's sad.
Ours
is going to the processor at the moment, but how long that will continue on for, we're not really quite sure.
Absolutely.
But I mean, obviously you can't keep making cheese because the store is full, and you know, if it's not going out the back door, then you know, We just don't have any room to put it anywhere.
And what impact do you think this hold on production will have, you know, even after lockdown ends?
Oh, gosh. I mean, this is... I think this is going to take the country and businesses years to recover. Mm. It really is. We're just all going to have to think about different ways of trading. And, I mean, obviously, the tourists... When will they come back and the hotels will then be busy again?
Yeah.
I mean, it's all a lot of ifs at the moment. And I think we just have to stay positive, do what we can do and, you know, get different markets if we can and just try our best. And, I mean, I think with any business, any owner is trying their best.
You know,
and I think that we're all... You know, we're all sort of in it together.
I agree.
It's not as if it's just happening to us. It's everybody. So
absolutely.
You know,
but I think you're right though, Jill. You know, I've known you for a long time, and you definitely fall into one of life's optimists camp. And I think that's important. You know, optimism can't get you everywhere, but I think it's hugely important at this time because I think the more optimistic your outlook, the more able you are to think about different ways of doing things and different solutions and innovations. And I know I love, just, even though you're an Aussie, I thought you came up with a brilliant Scottish term for your collection. What are you calling your cheese collection at the moment?
Now you've caught me. What is it? One toot and your order's oot.
Yes, that's it.
Well, Anna, I've been here for 26 years now. I've picked up a few.
You certainly have.
Picked up a bit of Scottish.
You certainly have. So basically, people are able to. You're still dispatching all over the UK, aren't you?
Yes.
But local people can order over the phone and come along to the car park and give you a toot and somebody toot. I'm Robert. I'm not any better with a Scottish accent either. and I know that I think it's important to have a laugh and be optimistic at this time despite the challenges, and I think you do that brilliantly. But you also told me a lovely story on the phone the other day about a lady, and I suppose it comes down to the kind of local food resurgence that we have seen during coronavirus. You told me a story of a lady who came to the shop and she said she'd been passing, never been in before. Can you just tell me about that?
Well, that's right. Well, she, this lady came in and she said, oh, I've never been here before. Oh, my goodness, you've got all these cheeses. Anyway, when it first happened and everybody went into panic mode, she said she rushed to the... she's got quite a few children. She'd rushed to the supermarket and bought block cheddar.
Mm-hmm.
And she said, oh, my goodness. She said, I got so sick of it. And she... And she just said, oh, my God, this is just wonderful. I can come here and get real cheese. Not that there's anything wrong with supermarket cheese, but I found that quite funny. So we've now got a new customer.
Oh, good. I'm sure you have many new customers. But whether it's cheese or meat in particular as well and fruit and veg, I think people are definitely...
Yes.
I suppose realising the importance of local produce. And it's really coming to the fore, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. And I mean, just down in the village, we've got McLeod Organics, and they have organic veg and things. And they've had a huge uplift of orders, which you know, we're supplying them with cheese, which is fantastic. But I think the thing is, I was talking to Nathan the other day, and he was saying people just suddenly realise... They look around and all of a sudden they're all these small producers that they've never realised before. And I think people are looking at that rather than going to the supermarket.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And, you know, in our area where I live, there are many people who only deal, you know, with wholesale ordinarily, but they're now doing consumer deliveries and they're getting things. So it's, I think people are starting to realise, I just hope, and I'm like you, I'm a kind of glass half full person, but I really yes. hope that this loyalty to local will continue after yes. after these awful circumstances are over.
I know, I hope so. You know, I think when people are home and they haven't got much else to do, they're looking at different recipes. They're looking, you know, different foods and how to prepare. Because yes. people have got time now. You think of our lives before this. Nobody had any time for anything, really,
no,
did we?
Absolutely.
We're all rushing around, and but now they're really thinking about the recipes that they can make, and you know, obviously the television, Jamie Oliver, and I mean, you know, lots of them have got cooking shows on, and,
yes.
and people are now thinking, you know, oh gosh, I'd quite like to use that. Oh, hang on, I need a reblochon, or I need some raclette, or I need, you know, different cheese.
Oh, reblochon, that's
oh, I know.
One of my favourites.
Tatiflette.
Connage Gouda is my ultimate
oh,
favourite, but I love reblochon.
Yeah. Well, Connage Gouda is a wonderful melter. I mean, if you have it on cheese on toast, it's just divine.
Oh, yeah. Oh, lovely.
I'll wander back. I just wanted to tell you about our new project. So I'll just say goodbye to Merrick and Magda. They're pretending that they're not seeing me. Bye. Oh, they're just fantastic. They really are. We've just got the big roller door to shut down.
You'd be a good person to ask about this, Jill, because I know that personally you're perhaps not the world's biggest fan of using social media because you've got so many other things to do and you're not necessarily the world's biggest fan of technology. But how would you say social media has been helpful to get you through the current times?
Do you know... just amazing, I have to say. I mean, anybody who doesn't use it for a business, I think they should. You know, when you've got so much on your plate every day, trying to sit down and concentrate on what you're going to put out on social media is really difficult. And get the wording right and look around for the right recipes. And that's where Anna, I mean... You've been a godsend to us, really, to be. You have. And,
oh,
you know,
thank
it's
you.
Just the fact that it's trying to, you know, get the message across. And that's something that you, sometimes during the day you don't really have time to do that.
Mm.
And,
yeah,
you know, absolutely. And it could be the end of the day, which is the wrong time to do it because you're tired.
Mm.
But it has had a huge effect on our business, definitely.
And crucial now, you know, when things are changing, you've got 30 new cheeses on your website, for example, you know, you have to communicate that information to customers somehow.
Yes.
And social media is the way to do it, as well as podcasting, obviously.
Oh, right. Yeah.
It's the way of doing it.
Well, I have to say, this is my first podcast. I've never done this before.
Well, you're a natural.
Okay, I'll tell you where we're standing now. We're just standing outside the shop area, and just opposite, Callum has taken down the old piggery that was there, and
okay.
Yeah, we've now got this brand new building, but which is not connected because the electrician is self-isolating, so we can't. He won't be out. But this is our new project of vending machines. So I know.
Oh, I love vending machines.
Yeah. Well, it's been in the plan for quite a while, but we just hadn't.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, one of the reasons we couldn't take down the piggery is because since January we've had such high winds here. It's really,
oh, right.
And you
yes.
know, it just wasn't safe to take it down. So eventually we've got it down. We've got the new building in place, but we just have to get it all connected and things. So this means
exciting.
That I know we'll have a milk vending machine, but we've also
yeah.
got a chilled vending machine. So we'll be able to sell our vacuum pack portions and any of the cheeses that we make. And also what I'm going to do is get different things in different seasons, so I can get you know, say Rory Stone from Harlem Fine Cheeses, get his vacuum pack portions of blue mm-hmm. cheese and things, you know, so there'll be a variety.
Oh, fab.
I know.
So then people don't have to wait. They don't necessarily need to know the shop hours all the time because they can come.
They can come and just help themselves.
They can come in the middle of the night if they want to. Yes, absolutely. Great idea. And it fits with people's lifestyles as well, doesn't it? Lifestyles are changing and people are busy people can just shop according to when suits them.
And I think now, once this is all over, people will start, as you say, start thinking about what they're eating. And then, you know, then go for local and go for local milk and, yeah. So,
yeah, this, absolutely.
So once we're up and running, we'll have to get you up and come and have a look.
Oh, definitely. Yeah, that'll be amazing. The other thing, we have a Polish guy who keeps his beehives. He owns a shop in Edinburgh, which is called the Edinburgh Honey Shop, I think, or Edinburgh Honey Company. He keeps some of his beehives on our farm, and I saw him the other day, and we spoke from about 4 meters away, just to be safe. And he was saying he really thinks that, you know, he's changed his business model too. So his shop is closed, but he does deliveries. And he was saying he really thinks that people in general will come out of this as nicer and more understanding and more empathetic people, because we sometimes, I'm not religious myself, but at the same time, I think maybe, you know, we all need, it's kind of a sign that we all need to just calm down our frenetic lifestyles. And he thinks that by being at home, spending more time with our families, and I realise, gosh, you know, key workers are not getting that opportunity to spend more time with their families, and I'm so grateful to them. But those of us who are stuck at home, as it were, with families, and, you know, time to think, I think maybe it will do us some good.
I hope
in the long run. And for businesses, just as importantly, it gives them the opportunity to innovate, do something different. And we've actually, we've heard of a lot of businesses who've thought, right, well, okay, we can't do what we thought we were going to be doing in April 2020, but actually we do need to revamp our website, so we're going to do that instead.
Oh, good.
And kind of, I suppose, future-proofing the business so that when things are up and running, you're ready. And I suppose that's the thing, that's what you've just described to us, is, you know, the vending machines was an idea that you already had.
Yes.
But this situation has made you realise how important an idea it was, and I suppose probably given you extra vigour to
it has. And, you know, these are sort of things that focusing on something new like this does give you extra energy. I mean, that's the thing, is it was such a shock, really, that, and I'm sure everybody was in the same boat, that you all of a sudden your lives had to change and our business had to change. It took sort of a week to kind of, you know, the staff are off and you know, away, and things were so strange. But then you kind of get this shot of positivity and think, right, okay, the whole world's in this situation. We need to just try and survive. And absolutely. I just hope everybody comes out of it a lot nicer than what was going on before, and especially on social media. And people are going to think, hopefully, a little bit more about it. So,
I think so. Yeah, absolutely. So, Jill, it sounds as though you maybe don't have gale force winds up there like you did in January, but it's a bit windy. I wonder, can you walk us back through to the office, maybe? And I know.
Yes, I'll just head back at the office. Actually, it's a relief. It's a little bit warmer in here.
We can't get you to describe at the moment the amazing cheese room, because there's a customer in there at the moment, and obviously we're operating social distancing.
That's right.
If you close your eyes and imagine it, because it's only a few feet away from you.
Yes.
Can you tell us a little bit about your chilled cheese room?
Well, the chilled cheese room, came to me in the middle of the night years and years ago. I know. Yeah, you can tell I don't sleep much, but anyway.
I hope you have a notebook by the bed, do you?
Yes. Well, it's my phone. Okay. I usually, you know, make notes on my phone.
Yeah.
But, so it was just the fact that we were using servovers in the actual shop area, and the cheeses weren't really, they weren't coping very well, and, you know, they didn't look great. And then the office used to be where the chilled cheese room is.
Yeah.
So I said to Callum, because he leaves early to get the milk, or did, you know, he'd leave the house about, I don't know, 10 to 6 or something. So we always used to have a cup of tea before he goes. And I said, oh, how about we turn the office into into a chief for retail. Well, I sort of got the raised eyebrow. So we went from there, and then we bought a sea container and put the office in the sea container. And then we kind of went from there, really. And, you know, it is a bit chilly. Sometimes it's colder outside than actually inside. So we're quite lucky in that respect. But it's just a perfect way to really display your cheeses. You can probably hear the dog. I don't know if you...
Oh, yeah, this is
Tess. Our black lab, she's one in your bed.
So she's allowed in the office.
Yeah, she's allowed in the office, but not anywhere else. In your bed.
No.
In your beddy. Go on, good girl. And so she keeps keeps us right, and also too
makes your toes warm.
Yes. So, we buy in different sort of cheeses from Europe and England, and I try and buy in cheeses that are not in the supermarket. It's just that I can't buy them in volume that the supermarket would. So, you know, obviously the price is quite different. But, you know, it's different having a selection of blues. We've got three Scottish ones at the moment, different European cheeses. And, of course, we're coming out of winter. We've had, you know, the melting cheeses from France and the Alps and... Then, of course, obviously we sell a lot of our cheese. We've got our new cheese, which is Gouda, garlic and nettle, and that's what Callum was...
Oh, yum.
That's his new one.
Yeah. His new baby.
His new baby. It's quite funny. When I go into the kitchen and he's boiling, because you have to boil up the nettles and the garlic before. Oh, my goodness, what a smell. And the thing is, the powder is quite fine, from the nettle bags. And so I went in there one day and he had he's all dressed in his whites with a cap on and everything, boiling up this thing. And the whole room was just covered in green, fine dust. So,
is that your kitchen? Does he practice his recipe?
No, this is at the dairy. So it was really, oh gosh, I wouldn't let him loose in my kitchen, I tell you. But it was very funny, honestly. He had a fine green dust over his face. He looked.
Oh, dear. The things you have to do to perfect cheesemaking.
Well, that's right. Yeah, oh, definitely. Yeah. Oh, yes, part of the process. But we did have quite a few laughs.
So how many cheeses does that make now then in the Connage collection?
Oh, so we've got Dunlop, and we smoke the Dunlop here at the dairy, traditional smoke. We've got Cromwell, which is the slightly younger and crumblier one. We do Gouda. We have aged Gouda, which we won all the awards for last year. We've got plain Gouda, Gouda with cumin, Gouda with garlic and nettle. We've got the Clava Brie, the Highland Heart, which is really the Clava recipe, just in the shape of a heart.
In the shape of a heart. Perfect for Valentine's Day.
Well, that was... Do you remember that, Anna? Because remember we ran a campaign with the heart and we didn't know what to call it. And
I remember.
Do you remember? And we did you did a competition on social media.
Yes,
and
to choose the name. Yeah.
That's it. And we sent the person a box of cheese. So that's terrific. And we've got... we do yogurt, but not at the moment, of course, because production's not producing. And also we're in business with, or collaboration really, not business, but collaboration with Hebridean Smokehouse. And we send our crowdie over to them and they add peat, smoked salmon and black pepper. And that's lovely. And, what else do we do? Oh, we smoke the brie as well. Yes. And that's such a different flavour. I didn't think it would take off, but it's actually doing rather well.
And so, again, a kind of another adaptation in the current circumstances is that normally you have, you know, many, many cheeses in the cheese room, but available online is a much, much smaller selection. But under current circumstances, you've added many more cheeses online. So if people are placing an order for delivery anywhere in the UK, they can choose from a wider range and keep the kids happy regardless of what cheese they prefer.
I mean, I think the thing is really is that we've dropped off nearly all of the really soft, short dated cheeses. Mm-hmm. And that's just because we're just not getting enough people here to buy. So we don't do that. But it's mostly harder cheeses. But there are a few soft goat's cheeses, like the Golden Cross, which is a beautiful goat's cheese, a log. So, you know, we try and sort of really look at how we can, you know, keep them, but keep the cheeses in really good condition so that people want. Yeah, yeah.
And are you selling at the moment online accompaniments like oatcakes and things like that?
Yes, yeah. Yes. I have to say, Anna, you'd be very proud of me because, you know, I mean, I'm not a technophobe, but I mean, I do find it difficult, you know, having to concentrate on. But I've actually put these products online myself.
Oh, well done.
There were a few little blue moments when it didn't work. But anyway, we've got it all on, and so I'm refreshing every day and looking at different products and things. Yes, getting a lot more of the dry goods on. So that's this on Saturday. I'll be putting some more on as well. And so
you've been upskilling yourself during this process as well by learning how to put everything up on the website. Yeah,
mind you, Callum is in the office and he's always there when I have a little hissy fit about it. he comes over and offers. Callum's very calm, you know.
and
works through it methodically, where I'm sort of the big picture girl and I just want it done, you know. Oh dear.
So Jill, I wonder if we could maybe finish up. What do you think you've learned from dealing with the current coronavirus crisis? And then secondly, what would be your message to the general public as a result of what's been going on?
What I think all of us have learned is patience. Mind you, when it comes to the computer, probably not me, but I have actually learned a bit. But it's really just patience, and things will get done, and we can't rush this because we have absolutely no control. And I think whenever you think about your life pre-COVID-19, we were always in control. But now it's out with our control. So you have to learn patience, and that's something that we've all, you know, have lost sight of since sort of, you know, we're living in a fast world. So maybe that's something that I've learned is we will get there. It's okay. We've got to remain positive. We will get there. And business-wise, you know, is the same. It's really trying to work out new things, but just have that patience that this is going to work. You know, I just, as I said before, I mean, it's just been overwhelming for Callum and I, the wonderful support that we've had from our customers and, you know, just when you speak to them on the phone, and we always have a chat about how they're coping at home, and, you know, we try and sort of try and find the funny side of different things that are happening in their lives as well. But I think also too is the public will realise that, you know, local producers are important. Maybe having the patience to shop locally, because it does sometimes, you know, you have to drive a little bit further, or, mm-hmm. you know, you have to have the patience to do that.
Yeah,
whereas
yeah.
it's so easy to go into the supermarket. I mean, not that there's anything wrong with supermarkets, but, you know, they're very price driven, and it's just so nice to connect with people. And I think after us, you know, being so locked away in our houses, I think now when we all come out, you know, socializing is just going to be such a joy.
Yeah, absolutely.
And it will. And I think that, you know, people will hopefully really enjoy that, instead of rushing to the shop and sort of standing on one foot and the other because they're in a hurry. Now we're all going to stand around and have a chat.
Yeah, you know? Absolutely. That's so true.
Yeah.
We do need to just take a breath and
yes.
appreciate what we've got when we come out of this. I think.
Yeah, yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
I mean, I just hope all the NHS staff or any support staff, you know, I just hope they remain well, as the, you know, things, you know, just sound so. I mean, I listened to the, you know, to the new announcements in the afternoon from the government, but I've actually switched off the news now. And it's quite difficult because, you know, I really love sport and, you know, I'm missing the rugby and, you know, the cricket and all that sort of thing.
Yeah.
So we have to pick up that book now. Yeah.
Yes, absolutely. Slower pace of life.
Yes, do us or definitely. For a bit. Definitely. Yeah.
And hats off to all of those. Well, hats off to your team, who are key workers in the food sector. And hats off to everybody else who's a key worker, NHS, and all the others too. We couldn't do it without them.
Oh, that's for sure. Mm. That's for sure.
So, Jill, just before I go off for my cheese on toast for lunch, can you just tell us, for the sake of everybody whose tummy's rumbling now, how people can place an order with you for delivery across the UK?
Certainly. We have our website, www.conage.co.uk. You can order through there. If you're having any difficulty ordering or you would like to collect from the dairy, please give me a ring on 01667 46 2000. We do have an answering machine and I will get back to you. I think I put my mobile number on there as well, just in case if you're wanting to get something. But please ring in. We can certainly help you with any cheese you need. And I think one of the great family favourites, which you love, Anna, isn't it, and your children love, is the Gouda.
Yes.
So we have plenty of that. Yes. And I think one of my favourite things is cheese on toast.
Well, thank you very much for listening. I think that's worked relatively well under the circumstances, even though Jill and I are several hundred miles apart and I'm not on farm as I would like to be. I hope you've enjoyed it and found it interesting and hopefully a little bit inspiring. But please do subscribe to the On Farm podcasts so that you can get each new episode straight to your phone. Thanks for listening.